pride in the panther as he glows in splendor and grace, toppling obstacles placed in the way of the progression of his race. Can you see the pride in the panther as she nurtures her young all alone? The seed must grow regardless of the fact that it's planted in stone. Can't you see the pride in the panthers as they unify as one? The flower blooms with brilliance and outshines the rays of the sun. Outshines like the sun, shines out like the sun, shines bright like the sun, brings light like the sun.
P is for power, the A for action, the NT because now is the time to get it done. See, the H is for heart and the E for effect. The R hold it down at the end for respect. Who am I, a panther? Who am I, a panther? What I got, I got soul. What I got, I got love. What I got, I got pride. What I wanna be free. Raise your hands in the air if you feel like me. Who am I, a panther? Who am I, a panther? What I got, I got soul. What I got, I got love. What I got, I got pride. What I wanna be free. Raise your hands in the air if you feel like me.
This song is dedicated to all those who live and die for the struggle. Panthers, children of the Panthers, all those who strive for free minds, free souls, free bodies, and freedom and love. Love. Love is the answer to the revolution.
What's your name?
Cameron.
Say it loud.
Cameron.
Cameron, you got honor roll, Cameron?
Yes.
You do?
Yes. I got honor roll.
You got honor roll too?
Yes.
You got honor roll too? Everybody on the squad got honor roll, huh?
Yes, sir.
The whole squad got honor roll. You got honor roll?
Dagger.
I know you ain't got honor roll. No, we got to see how you fuck off, bro. We got to see how you fuck off.
Honor roll?
Malik don't have honor roll, right? Hold up.
I'm gonna give you it.
Nah, bro, you gotta get honor roll next time, son.
See, I notice in everything that you have said that it appears to me that your concept of socialism is not a doctrinaire one. The charge that you are all communists or that you're all Maoists, it seems to me that what you say adds up to the fact that you're approaching the idea of socialism from a pragmatic standpoint, in the view of this situation, racially, economically, and in its world position. Would that be correct, and could you expand on it?
Yes, but not only that, I think that it's not so much as being doctrinaire. We're not doctrinaire, because we're more interested in really dealing with the social forces than adhering to some so-called Marxist-Leninist principle, which might not be Marxist-Leninist after all, because Marx himself said that one thing that I'm not a Marxist. And what he meant, that he wasn't going to follow any doctrinaire thing. He was going to use the science of materialism in a creative fashion, and that makes the true Marxist-Leninist, you see. But what is really happening is that we've carried Marxist-Leninism to a higher level. We say that the party, the Black Panther Party, is the greatest Marxist-Leninist of all times, and we're not bragging when we say that, but we realize that history has bestowed upon us an obligation, and that is to take the science and take the philosophy of Marx to its final goal, and that is to create a world that has an absence of statehood. And this is why, in the first of my talk with you, I emphasize the fact that we're no longer revolutionary nationalists, that we don't believe what's commonly called nationhood for America, you see. We believe that America now must subscribe to strict internationalism, because while these other revolutionary countries are and who are Marxist-Leninists are revolutionary nationalists in the respect that they are fighting for autonomy and they're fighting for independence and nationhood, we support that because they have to do that in order to defend themselves against the international bourgeoisie, the international aggressor. We realize that if America didn't support every fascist and bourgeois government in the world, that government couldn't exist and the people would win their revolution immediately. So what I'm saying is that while it might sound in contradiction, it's only paradoxical that when I say that blacks, we should ask the black people exactly what direction we want to go, we also are going to explain some things to them, and that is that whatever way we go, that white America can no longer remain a nation. And taking this under consideration, I'm saying that once America stopped relating to this nationalism, it won't be necessary for any other country in the world to relate to nationalism. So taking these, developing these kind of concepts, we think that we've taken Marxist-Leninism to even a higher level than it's ever been in history, because history has not yet created the communist world. It's only created the socialist world that is also based upon statehood. So the next stage would be the communist world, where statehood no longer exists. And we will take the banner of the people's struggle, the black and the red banner, to the final victory.
Is there anything else you would like to say to us, Huey?
I would like to say power to the people, because without the people, there will be no victory. And the people are responsible for historical developments, and they're responsible for the course that history takes. And no matter what kind of weapon the oppressor has, that we know that one new weapon doesn't win the war, but the people always win. And the people are the real heroes, and without this knowledge, we don't have even the rudimentary knowledge.
Thank you very much.
All power to the people. Welcome to the Bobby Hutton Political Education Course. Yo, we in week 6 already. All power, all power. Welcome to Bobby Hutton Political Education Course. Each week, students will be assigned readings and videos to study and will convene once a week to discuss the material, interpret and break down the core concepts, questions and answers, and to prepare for next week's study material. Remember that taking notes can be really beneficial, even audio ones, and don't be afraid to ask for help. We are all in this together. Each week, you're encouraged to bring the following: quotes from the material, questions you have, your interpretation of the material, core concept, and revolutionary spirit. The first duty of a revolutionary is to be educated. To be a Panther, we must understand our history, our political line, strategies to overthrow our oppressors. Upon completion of the political education program, graduates will become members of the UPM, receive recognition, and be encouraged to begin organizing in their local communities. Comrades, our study this week will focus on a basic discussion on historical dialectical materialism and revolutionary intercommunalism. Pantherism is based on the revolutionary science of dialectical materialism, first developed by Karl Marx and further developed by Vladimir Lenin, Mao Zedong, and others, including Huey P. Newton, the co-founder of the original Black Panther Party in 1966. When applied to the study of human social evolution, it is called historical dialectical materialism. It stands opposed to metaphysical idealism, which has been the dominant way people have taught and tried to explain the world since ancient time. All right, so metaphysical idealism is religion. They're basically saying, well, what we are reading here is basically telling you the two ways people have sought to describe reality or what's going on or where we come from. On one group, one way, the dominant way of understanding reality has been through religion. That's what those in power have always fed to the people. They give them religion for them to to be able to describe and understand the world around them. But they're saying here that there's a new theory, a new way of looking at the world that was brought upon by Karl Marx, Lenin, Mao, and later on, people like U.P. Newton. All religions are based on this sort of thinking, see? Taken to its logical conclusion, you will believe nothing exists outside your own brain and everything is an illusion. And they will lock you up as hopelessly insane. Materialism, on the other hand, asserts that reality really does exist, independent of how we think about it. In other words, your gravity is real. If you jump outside that window, gravity gonna catch you. And that floor gonna catch you. And it existed before there were any humans to think about it. Before humans were here to think about gravity, gravity was here. Everything exists as a matter and energy is matter in motion. Right, let me bring that back. Everything exists as matter and energy is matter in motion. Everything is in motion and everything is changing all the time. Dialectics is the study of matter in motion and asserts everything exists as a unity of opposites that are in contradiction and struggle, with things transforming into their opposites when the primary aspect is overcome by the secondary aspect. That's deep. We'll get deeper into that. But right now, it is important to see that this way of thinking is revolutionary and will overthrow the outmoded and incorrect view that has dominated people's thinking in the past. So in other words, it's gonna do away with people just thinking everything is because of a boogeyman that's in the sky or because of religion, that we exist because of religion. Karl Marx developed the scientific method of analysis, which came to be called dialectical materialism by those who came after him. As an analytical tool, dialectic materialism provides a method for understanding the laws of material existence and for changing material conditions by acting within these laws. I'm gonna read that back again. As an analytical tool, DM provides a method of understanding the laws of material existence and for changing material conditions by acting within these laws. In other words, like, we can change reality. We can change our social conditions if you understand the rules and the laws and how to operate within them. Historical materialism is the application of dialectic materialism to the study and understanding of social development and history. So using dialectic materialism, you can understand what has happened in the past and what will happen in the future. Marx understood that the brain, the very medium of our thoughts and ideas, is itself a material construct. It grows and develops with and as a result of material conditions without which it would cease to be and could not generate thoughts. Like, we're going through this so you understand how we think, how we come to the decisions that we make, the strategies, and how we move. I'm reading this first part again. Marx understood the brain, the very medium of our thoughts, is itself a material construct. What does it mean by that? Like, everything that you know right now, everything in your brain, it's a social construct, everything that you've learned, because our brains are like computers. Our brains take in information, and then we work them informations out in our brain, and then we like bring out, what will be the output, whatever it brings out, it has to take information in. If the brain doesn't take information in, it can't really make decisions or come up with answers. I think that's what this is trying to explain. Purged of metaphysical influences, dialectics regard nature as connected and unified whole, as a combination of organically bound phenomena that are interdependent and affect each other's development. Therefore, no activity in nature can be understood if it is isolated from surrounding phenomena. To understand the thing, you got to understand everything around it. You can't just understand one little small part of it without knowing everything else that comes with it, because everything is connected. We're going to come back to this stuff because, like, what we're going to talk about today has a lot to do with how you use dialectic materialism to understand the politics of the day of what's going on in real time. Metaphysics, religion, teaches the that nature exists in an absolute and unchanging state. The dialectical method teaches that nature remains in a state of constant change, development, and renewal. This can be seen through scientific and even general studies of nature and natural processes. Nothing remains the same. The philosophers have only interpreted the world in various ways. The point, however, is to change it. Here's her, a Secretary General. Man, look, man, this African tongue, bro. Hitherto, men have constantly made up for themselves false conceptions about themselves, about what they are and what they ought to be. They have arranged their relationships according to their ideas of God, of normal man, etc. The phantoms of their brains have gotten out of their hands. They, the creators, have bowed down before their creations. One has to leave philosophy aside. One has to leap out of it and devote oneself like an ordinary man to the study of actuality, for which there exists also an enormous amount of literary material, unknown, of course, to the philosophers. The question whether objective truth can be attributed to human thinking is not a question of theory, but it's a practical question. Man must provide the truth, i.e., the reality and power, the decidedness of his thinking in practice, the dispute over the reality or non-reality of thinking, which is isolated from practice, is a purely scholastic question. I don't know if I should explain this now or if I should wait till we get to the videos and stuff and what we're really talking about this in today's class. I mean, but I know there's a lot of words and it's hard for people to really understand what he's really saying here. The question whether objective truth can be attributed to human thinking is not a question of theory, but it's a practical question. We can be objective, not subjective. We can be objective. We can look at evidence and be able to use the science and whatever is there to be able to make our decisions. You don't have to make decisions based on preconceived notions of what you believe is supposed to be. I mean, like, it can be done. In practice, it can be done where you can see phenomena and be able to use purely science to understand what you're dealing with. I'm trying to think how to put this into words. At one point, the explanation for everything, like I said, most of the world, the way people understood things was through religion. So the explanation for everything was spiritual. It wasn't scientific. Like I gave you the example about gravity. I mean, so it's like this is, I don't know the science, but scientists understand why gravity functions the way it works. Why if I jump out this window, they know the science, they know the application, they know all of that. You see, I don't know it because I am not a scientist, but I can learn that. I can learn for myself why that is so. And I don't have to say, you know what? Yo, if you commit a sin, I mean, God gonna bring you down to the ground. Or some idiotic, I mean, like that, to explain the phenomena that I don't know how to explain. But it can be done. You can explain it. You can explain why things happen. If you study it enough, if you know the both sides, and if you put enough energy into it to understand everything around it, you can understand why things behave and move the way they do. But dialectic doesn't merely see things in a state of motion where there's only increase or decrease in quantity without fundamental change in quality. This means that phenomena moves and develop not in straight lines, but in spiral. These qualitative and overlapping changes are seen as leaps. An example of change from quantity to quality can be seen in how all matter changes in quality. according to the quantity of temperature from gas to liquid to solid. Without proper analysis on material conditions and their internal and external contradictions, it is impossible to develop a proper understanding of them. In order to really know an object, we must embrace, study all its sides, all connections and mediations. We never achieve this completely, but the demand for all-sidedness is a safeguard against mistakes in reality. Vladimir Lenin. You have to know all sides. You can't just know one side of the story, or like somebody come to tell you something to make you hate somebody else, so you ride with them because they're your friend, because you've known them, because they're your family. So you ride with them and you make a judgment based on what they said without even hearing the other side. I mean, the only way to really understand both sides is you got to listen to both sides and you got to take in the evidence from both sides, and then you come to your own final solution of what happened. All power to the people. Huey P. Newton, everybody celebrating Huey P. Newton's birthday yesterday. Yeah, man, all power. Man, we showed a clip of Huey P. Newton speaking earlier. If you're here in this class, you should know who Huey P. Newton is by now. Is that you? You should know who Huey P. Newton is by now. Huey P. Newton is one of the co-founders of this party. And when we're talking about dialectic materialism, everything that we're talking about here, this is science and work that they put in place for us later, 40, 50, 60 years later, for us to now follow in their footsteps to understand the world as they saw it, as they learned it to be. So like, that's why we're here today. And we always have to pay homage to these people. No, they're not perfect. Nobody's perfect. I am not perfect. You're not perfect. Nobody is perfect. We all make mistakes and we are all wrong sometimes. But that doesn't mean you don't take the science or you don't follow with the science that they have left. That's the whole point of historical dialectic materialism. Everything that we do is based on science. Nobody here just guesses and just makes up things and just goes along with it. Every single thing that we do here, everything that we do is based on science. It's based on dialectic materialism. And dialectic materialism is basically scientific. The Secretary General is about to come read this speech. It's about a few slides, but this speech was given in 1970 in Boston. All power to the people.
All power to the people. Revolutionary Intercommunalism by Huey P. Newton, Boston College, 1970. Now, I will give you roughly some characteristics that any people who call themselves a nation should have. These are economic independence, cultural determination, control of political institutions, territorial integrity, and safety. In 1966, we called our party a Black Nationalist Party. We called ourselves Black Nationalists because we thought that nationhood was the answer. Shortly after that, we decided that what was really needed was revolutionary nationalism. That is, nationalism plus socialism. After analyzing conditions a little more, we found that it was impractical and even contradictory. Therefore, we went to a higher level of consciousness. We saw that in order to be free, we had to crush the ruling circle, and therefore we had to unite with the peoples of the world. So we called ourselves internationalists. We sought solidarity with the peoples of the world. We sought solidarity with what we thought were the nations of the world. But then what happened? We found that because everything is in a constant state of transformation, because of the development of technology, because of the development of mass media, because of the firepower of the imperialists, and because of the fact that the United States is no longer a nation, but an empire, nations could not exist, for they did not have the criteria for nationhood. Their self-determination, economic determination, and cultural determination has been transformed by the imperialists in the ruling circle. They were no longer nations. We found that in order to be internationalists, we had to be also nationalists, or at least acknowledge nationhood. Internationalism, if I understand the word, means the interrelationship among a group of nations. But since no nation exists, and since the United States is in fact an empire, it is impossible for us to be internationalists. These transformations and phenomena require us to call ourselves intercommunalists because nations have been transformed into communities of the world. The Black Panther Party now disclaims internationalism and supports intercommunalism. Marx and Lenin felt, with the information they had, that when the non-state finally came to be reality, it would be caused or ushered in by the people and by communism. A strange thing happened. The ruling reactionary circle, through the consequence of being imperialists, transformed the world into what we call reactionary intercommunalism. They laid siege upon all the communities of the world, dominating the institutions to such an extent that the people were not served by the institutions in their own land. The Black Panther Party would like to reverse that trend and lead the people of the world into the age of revolutionary intercommunalism. This would be the time when the people seize the means of production and distribute the wealth and the technology in an egalitarian way to many communities of the world. We see very little difference in what happens to a community here in North America and what happens to a community in Vietnam. We see very little difference in what happens, even culturally, to a Chinese community in San Francisco and a Chinese community in Hong Kong. We see very little difference in what happens to a Black community in Harlem and a Black community in South America, a Black community in Angola, and one in Mozambique. We see very little difference. So, what has actually happened is that the non-state has already been accomplished, but it is reactionary. A community, by way of definition, is a comprehensive collection of institutions that serve the people who live there. It differs from a nation because a community evolves around a greater structure that we usually call the state. And the state has certain control over the community if the administration represents the people or if the administration happens to be the people's commissar. It is not so at this time, so there's still something to be done. I mentioned earlier the negation of the negation. I mentioned earlier the necessity for the redistribution of wealth. We think that it is very important to know that as things are in the world today, socialism in the United States will never exist. Why? It will not exist because it cannot exist. It cannot at this time exist any place in the world. Socialism would require a socialist state. And if a state does not exist, how could socialism exist? So how do we define certain progressive countries, such as the People's Republic of China? How do we describe certain progressive countries or communities, as we call them, as the Democratic People's Republic of Korea? How do we define certain communities, such as North Vietnam and the provisional government in the South? How do we explain these communities if, in fact, they too cannot claim nationhood? We say this. We say they represent the people's liberated territory. They represent a community liberated, but that community is not sufficient. It is not satisfied. Just as the National Liberation Front is not satisfied with the liberated territory in the South. It is only the groundwork and preparation for the liberation of the world, seizing the wealth from the ruling class, equal distribution and proportional representation in an intercommunal framework. This is what the Black Panther Party would like to achieve with the help of the power of the people, because without the people, nothing can be achieved. I stated that in the United States, socialism would never exist. In order for a revolution to occur in the United States, you would have to have a redistribution of wealth, not on a national or an international level, but on an intercommunal level. Because how can we say that we have accomplished revolution if we redistribute the wealth just to the people here in North America, when the ruling circle itself is guilty of trespass, deboni aspertatis? I don't know if I said that right, but there you go. That is, they have taken away the goods of the people of the world, transported them to America, and used them as their very own. In 1917, when the revolution occurred, there could be a redistribution of the wealth on the national level, because nations existed. Now, if you talk in terms of planning an economy on a worldwide level, on an intercommunal level, you are saying something important, that the people have been ripped off very much like one country being ripped off. In order to plan a real intercommunal economy, we will have to acknowledge how the world is hooked up. We will also have to acknowledge that nations have not existed for some time. Some people will argue that nations still exist because of cultural differences. By way of definition, just for practical argument, culture is a collection of learned patterns of behavior. Here in the United States, Black people, Africans, were raped from the mother country, and consequently, we have literally lost most of our African values. Perhaps we still hold on to some surviving Africanisms, but by and large, you can see the transformation, which was achieved by time and the highly technological society whose tremendous mass media function as an indoctrination center. The ruling circle has launched satellites in order to project a beam across the earth and indoctrinate the world. And while there might be some cultural differences, these differences are not qualitative, but quantitative. In other words, if technology and the ruling circle go on as they are now, the people of the world will be conditioned to adopt Western values. I think Japan is a good example. The differences between people are getting very small, but again, that is in the interest of the ruling circle. I do not believe that history can be backtracked. If the world is really that interconnected, then we have to acknowledge that and say that in order for the people to be free, they will have to control the institutions of their community and have some form of representation in the technological center that they have produced. The United States, in order to correct its robbery of the world, will have to first return much of it has stolen. I don't see how we can talk about socialism when the problem is world distribution. I think that is what Marx meant when he talked about the non-state. I was at Alex Haley's house some time ago and talked to me about his search for his past. He found it in Africa, but when he returned there shortly afterward, he was in a state of panic. His village hasn't changed very much, but when he went there, he saw an old man walking down the road, holding something that he cherished to his car. It was a small transistor radio that was zeroed in on the British Broadcasting Network. What I'm trying to say is that mass media, plus the development of transportation, make it impossible for us to think of ourselves in terms of separate entities, as nations. Do you realize it only took me approximately 5 hours to get from San Francisco to here? It only takes 10 hours to get from here to Vietnam. The ruling circle no longer even acknowledges wars. They call them police actions. They call the riots of the Vietnamese people domestic disturbance. What I am saying is that the ruling circle must realize and accept the consequence of what they have done. They know that there is only one world, but they are determined to follow the logic of their exploitation. A short time ago in Detroit, the community was under siege, and now 16 members of the party are in prison. The local police laid siege on that community and their house. They used the same weapons they used in Vietnam. As a matter of fact, two tanks rolled up. The same thing happens in Vietnam because the police are there also. The police are everywhere. And they all wear the same uniform and use the same tools and have the same purpose, the protection of the ruling circle here in North America. It is true that the world is one community, but we are not satisfied with the concentration of its power. We want the power for the people. I said earlier, but I strayed away, that the theory of the negation is valid. Some scholars have been wondering why in Asia, Africa and Latin America, the resistance always seeks the goal of a collective society. They seem not to institute the economy of the capitalists. They seem to jump all the way from feudalism to a collective society, and some people can't understand why. Why won't they follow historical Marxism or historical materialism? Why won't they go from feudalism to the development of a capitalistic base? And finally, to socialism. They don't do it because they can't do it. They don't do it for the same reason that the Black community in Harlem cannot develop capitalism, that the Black community in Oakland or San Francisco cannot develop capitalism, because the imperialists have already preempted the field. You're a dispersed collection of communities. Because the Black Panther Party is not embarrassed to change or admit error, tonight I would like to accept the criticism and say that those critics were absolutely right. We are a collection of communities, just as the Korean people, the Vietnamese people, and the Chinese people are a collection of communities. It's a dispersed collection of communities because we have no superstructure of our own. The superstructure we have is the superstructure of Wall Street, which all of our labor produced. This is a distorted form of collectivity. Everything's been collected, but it's used exclusively in the interest of the ruling circle. This is why the Black Panther Party denounces Black capitalism and says that all we can do is liberate our community, not only in Vietnam, but here, not only in Cambodia and the People's Republics of China and Korea, but the communities of the world.
All power.
All power to the people. So everybody already know what's been going on. Everybody, if you're politically aware, if you watch the media, you watch the news, this has been all over the news. That's all they've been talking about. They've been talking about Fannie Willis. And I got a couple of messages this week. People asking me, what do I think about Fannie Willis? So we just heard UEP Newton give a speech, whatever, talking about how we should see ourselves, that we really don't have a nation, that we're all in communities. What does he mean by that? Well, he said what he mean by that, that our reality is basically controlled by Wall Street. But let's go deeper into that. What does UEP really mean about that? And believe me, the dialectic materialism and what UEP Newton said, all of it put together, will give you an explanation of the person that we see on the screen right now about Fannie Willis. You know, it's some Black people right now that when you see them and you talk to them, they believe we're all free. They take up for the police. I see them. Some of them even call themselves activists. They take up for the police. But where some of us understand the police are armed agents of the state, are armed agents of Wall Street, the same Wall Street UP Newton was talking about. That's what the police are here to do. They protect the imperialists from the rest of us, from the masses. They're not our friends. They're not our allies. We don't take up for the police. We don't support the police. That's why none of our luminaries, none of our heroes or celebrities, or freedom fighters ever stood on the side of the police. They always told us, F the police. I mean, George Jackson, Huey P., Malcolm, all these different people, they did not stand with the police, because they understood that the police protected the oppressors. That's their only purpose to exist. Now, what does Fannie Willis do? Fannie Willis, her whole entire career, have worked for imperialism. That's what she's done. We're going to go into her background, into who she is in a little bit. But you have to understand first the difference between the two. Because remember, like, when I was reading about dialectic materialism, you have to understand, you have to take the whole and break it in two and understand both sides of the whole and understand the contradictions. And understanding the contradictions in the whole, in the thing, in the person, is how you can get to the essence, the truth of what's going on. The splitting in two of the single whole and the cognition of its contradictory parts is the essence of dialectic materialism, of dialectics. In other words, what I was just saying, you have to take a whole and you have to split it open and you have to understand the contradictions in both sides for you to be able to understand the essence of what's going on. Now, what is the whole of Fannie Willis? Who is Fannie Willis? Yo, I'm telling you, like when I first started reading, and it was a part that said, like, the first thing of a revolutionary is political education. You know, we don't run away from learning. Because when I started getting those text messages, I didn't know who Fannie Willis is. I knew of her, but I really didn't know about her. I really didn't understand who she was. I didn't understand her career path. I didn't understand none of that. So like when people started sending me to Texas, like I can just answer people and I really don't know this person. And in fact, I think my man Jack here, all power Jack, my man Jack here, because he sent it to me too. And he was like, yo, do you know her? I like, not really. Like I know of her, but I really don't know. So after I got off the phone with him, I told him I'm gonna go do some research on her. She was born in California. Her father was a lawyer. He claimed to be, he said he started, he was what he was founder of a Black Panther organization, but it broke apart because of internal fighting. As Panthers, we don't believe in imperialism. We don't believe in the government. We don't trust the government. We fight against the government. So if you are a lawyer, your job is to uphold the laws of the government, to uphold the state, to uphold imperialism. That's who her father was. He was a lawyer. This was his job on the plantation. Because everybody need to understand, if we don't believe we are free, if we say we are not free, then we are all on the plantation. I consider myself on the plantation. I'm not really free. I'm not free to do what I want to do. I'm not free to go where I want to go. I'm not free to live. The only way I can live is by going to find some rich person for me to go slave away my life to them, for them to pay me, for me to be able to pay rent, for me to be able to survive. And then they have this police that's terrorizing me. They got this banks, this land, all these people that's here to oppress me. So I am not free from none of that. And I still understand I am being oppressed. So I don't consider myself a free person. Now, if I don't consider myself a free person and I look at the government as my enemy, what do I consider people that work in that government? Think about that for a second. What do you consider people that uphold those governments? You have to ask yourself these questions. And once you ask yourself those questions, you're going to start to see the contradictions that come about. So we're not free. And you inside the government, working in the government, the same government that I'm saying is oppressing me, that's writing laws, putting things in place to oppress me. And you're talking about you're a black person, you're working in the government, and you're supposed to be a role model, somebody that people should look up to. There's a contradiction there. It's not making sense. You got to make it make sense. It don't make sense at all. So who is Fannie Willis? Her father was a lawyer. She grew up, she left California, moved to DC, I think in the first grade, went to school out there, graduated from a Catholic all-girls school. When out of high school, went to Howard. Now, what is Howard? Howard is the Harvard for black people, for black elites. For black elites, a generation ago, a generation ago, where they send their children was to Howard. This is where what's her name? Kamala Harris graduated from Howard too, right? I think Cory Booker, all these people, Ralph Baraka, all these politicians. Because like you have to understand how all of this stuff connects. She graduated in 93. So she was there when Raz was there. So she was probably there when Ralph Baraka was there, like the same politician here. And what do they learn at these black schools, these so-called black schools? Because they call them black school, but they're funded by the government. They have contracts with the military industrial complex. They work for the United States government. They teach their students how to become capitalists. I know you heard Huey P. Newton saying he was a socialist, that capitalism, black capitalism, will save black people. But this is all what she embodies. She's not like the masses of black folks. These people, Fannie Willis, these are the people that benefited from the civil rights movement. The rich black people, the middle class black people, their children got access into institutions of imperialism or white supremacy, while the rest of us got what you call it, the school to prison pipeline. We got poison water. We had crimes in our communities. They didn't suffer like us in our community. Most of these people lived, they did what they were trying to do was move into those communities with more fluent people, with white people. That's what they were doing from the 60s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s. They were trying to find ways for them to get a piece of the oppressive pie. That's what Fannie Lewis, that's who she is, that's where she comes from. I'm about to play the video that's going to explain this case. This young sister right here, she's not a lawyer. Like she said, she's gonna say it. All she did was just read the documents. This, like, as far as I know, she's from the people. She's not doing this because she's being paid by the government. She's being paid by campaign donors. She just went and read the documents. So before I go further, I want you to hear from her what she's saying the case is about.
I'm not a lawyer, but that didn't stop me from reading through all of the available docs regarding Fannie Willis, her alleged boyfriend, his wife, and the Trump RICO case. Let me give you a recap about what's going on.
Disclaimer that my goal is only to recap what is being alleged in the documents. I'm not saying it's true, and I'm not saying it's not true. So none of this is my opinion. It's what one person is claiming against another. You can make your own judgments or see how it all plays out in court.
This is Fani Willis. She is the Fulton County District Attorney, Fulton County in Atlanta, Georgia, and she is responsible for many of the high-profile cases that you hear coming out of Georgia. The YSL RICO case, Ms. Fani Willis. The YFN RICO case, Ms. Fani Willis. The Trump RICO case, Ms. Fani Willis. She's kind of a big deal. Well, meet Michael Roman. He was a Trump campaign aide, and he is one of the 19 defendants charged in that Trump RICO case. And last week, Michael Roman and his attorney filed a motion to dismiss the RICO case and to disqualify Fani Willis and her office from prosecuting the case. Because according to them, one of the special prosecutors that she hired to prosecute the RICO case is actually her boyfriend. And they said she ain't mentioned that part when she hired him. And they also say that this boyfriend of hers is underqualified, overpaid, and he's using the money that he gets for working on the case to go on trips with Willis. They also say that because Fani Willis never received approval to hire this guy, which they say is Georgia law, the indictments that he assisted in getting are effectively invalid and have to be thrown out. Okay, let's start with the first point. Is that her man? The motion says that while it's not clear when the relationship started, individuals familiar with the situation say that Fani Willis and the man, whose name is Nathan Wade, were romantically involved prior to her hiring him to work on this case. It says that the two have cohabitated together in some form or fashion, and that on November 2nd, 2021, which was one day after Nathan Wade officially started working on this case, he filed for divorce from his wife. Oh, did I mention that? He was married. His divorce is still not finalized, and the proceedings for that are sealed. You know I checked. But Nathan's ex has apparently provided bank statements recently that confirm that Nathan Wade has purchased tickets for both himself and Fani Willis to places like Napa Valley, the Caribbean, and to cruises, which only matters because this motion claims that if Nathan is getting paid for working on this case and then spending some of the money on Willis, that means she is directly benefiting from the prosecution of this case, which would be a violation of her oath of office. Okay, now let's get into underqualified but overpaid. The motion says that based on speaking with individuals familiar with Nathan Wade and additional research done by Michael's attorney, Nathan Wade has never prosecuted a single felony trial. They say in a district where there are a number of fully capable attorneys who have experiences in prosecuting RICO cases and at the very least criminal trials, Fani Willis chose to hire Nathan Wade, who has no experience in either. And according to them, she's paid him a total of $653,881 over the span of a little over 2 years. And for the sake of comparison, Fani Willis is paid $198,266 per year. Okay, now let's talk about this approval that they're saying she didn't get and why that's a problem. The motion says that in 2021, Fani Willis presented to the Board of Commissioners seeking to get additional money for her district to clear her backlog of cases. Some of it was just a backlog, some of it was from COVID, and she also said that crime was on the rise in the district and she needed resources to address it. So the Board of Commissioners approved that request and give her the funding. This matters because the motion says that that money that she got didn't go to COVID backlog. It instead has been used to pay Nathan Wade and prosecute this case, allegedly. The motion also notes that Fani presenting to the board in 2021 proves that she is aware of how to get approval from that board. But yet, she chose not to get approval when it was time to hire Wade. And the motion says that she knew if she went to go get approval, they were going to ask her about her relationship with him and about his work experience, and she didn't want to answer that. The motion also says that prior to beginning work on this case, Nathan Wade never filed his oath of office. So according to Georgia law, he was never authorized to serve as a special prosecutor, which therefore means all of the work he's done, again, is invalid. So they say the indictment is void and that Fani and her office should be disqualified because of the conflict of interest on the case. Fani has until February 2nd to file a written response to this motion and an actual hearing has been scheduled for February 15th to talk about it all. But one more thing, remember how I said the divorce between Nathan and his ex, whose name is Jocelyn Wade, is not final yet? Well, child, Jocelyn, through her attorneys, has now subpoenaed Fonnie Willis to be deposed regarding her relationship with Nathan Wade. Fonnie got the subpoena and responded asking that the judge grant a protective order, which would mean that Fonnie cannot be deposed in this divorce because according to her, there isn't anything that she can say that will change the outcome of this irretrievably broken marriage, especially considering that the marriage was over after, quote, Jocelyn confessed to having an adulterous relationship with Nathan's longtime friend. Child, this is messy. Fonnie says Jocelyn is doing this just to harass her and damage her professional reputation. A hearing has been set for January 31st in the divorce proceedings because now Jocelyn wants all the divorce docs to be unsealed so we all can see them. This video was long, but I want to play this clip of Fonnie Willis at church last Sunday, seemingly addressing some of these allegations.
Why does Commissioner Thorne and so many others question my decision in a special counsel? I appointed 3 special counsel, as is my right to do, paid them all the same hourly rate. I hired 1 white woman, I hired 1 white man, and I hired 1 black man. Isn't it them who's playing the race card when they only question one?
Now y'all know, I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know if any of this will stand, but for the sake of optics, this don't look good.
Yeah, all power to the people. All power to the people. Look, we all understand, as black people and people of color, we all understand that we suffer under racism. We know we are being oppressed. But like I said, if you look into it, if you study a thing, you understand it is more than just race that has us catching hell. It is a class, it's a class thing with it too. When I see people like Fannie Willis up there trying to act like the white man is coming after her, the boogie white man that we should all be afraid of, we should be scared of, it really makes my stomach turn. Like, these people disgust me. Yo, you know what? You know when Fannie, when she first got her job, you know who she came after first? The first people she came after was public schools. This is like in 2009, 8, 10, 11. She came after teachers in public schools. This is when they were bringing the charter schools. She used RICO. Now, RICO is something that was put together to use against mobsters, murderers, people that are out there killing people on the street. Like, that's where they came up with RICO. Her, Fannie Willis, came into power, and she used RICO against teachers. Who did she go after next after she went after teachers? Black teachers, black women teachers. In fact, one of them had cancer and died before the trial was even over. Yo, Fannie didn't care. Fannie came after those people. Some of them, they got sentences like 20 years. All this year, they got probation. All this. Fannie didn't care. She came after them. You know who she came after that? Gang members. Gang members. Gangs are a product of the failure of society as a whole. That is why people become gang members. People join gangs for survival. Nobody just wake up one day and be like, yo, I'm going to go join the gang. Yo, it's part of the end, some of the communities that we're in. She went after gang members. Yo, does this person look like somebody that's pro-black? First, they went after teachers. After she went after teachers, she went after gang members. You see, none of those people could fight back. And she used going after gang members to take down some rap stars. I think, was it Young Thug?
Yeah,
I think YSL, Young Thug, whatever. She in Atlanta. She used, because I know some artists. I know some kids here in Newark, like they're like 17, 18, 19. They're part of a gang. They're also rappers, and they rap about the issues that they deal with in the community. So now when they get some money because they were in the gang and you go after all the people that are in the gang and you go bring them down, like none of that is pro-black to me. None of that look like you're with the people. You're standing with the people. And when she, all them trips, they talking about, so now dude is making about $315,000 a year from being on that case that he's not qualified to be on. And he's using that money to take her on trips. Like every 3 months, they're going to Napa Valley, they're going to all these places while she's locking up teachers, going after gang members, people in the community, in the community that are trying to struggle to survive. Because yo, this podcast, everything that we're doing here, we're trying to reach out to the gang members. We're trying to reach out to the people that the world has given up on. I don't want nobody to make a mistake about who my target audience is. My target audience is the lumping proletariat, the people that the world has given up on, because I know it's not their fault. I know it's a social construct put in place to make them who they are and to keep them where they're at. So my purpose as a Panther using dialectic materialism is to give my life for those people. So when I sit here, when I go work with kids on a daily basis, I'm working with kids because I want to prevent them from having to feel like they need to join a gang. I don't get up and go attack other people that are not the problem. I go after the people that are the problem, the politicians, the police. These are the people that are my enemies. Yo, my son made a live this week, and he was talking about me in the live, saying all I do is go around fighting people, all of that stuff on my social media page. It's all on my social media page. He tried to use his platform to try to make me look like a savage, somebody that's just out here reactionary. Yo, I dare anybody go look at my social media page. Political education classes, our after-school program, the work that we're doing in the community, that's all that's up there. And the police trying to stop me from entering venues because of the politicians in the city are telling the police to stop me from entering venues to speak. That's what you're going to see on my page. But that's not what my son said, because my son is part of this whole clique, this class war that they have against us. So he got on his page to go have a whole program to defend Fannie Willis, the person that came into office and locked up teachers. Yo, Google it, in Atlanta. Oh, what was his name? The young man's name. Yo, during George Floyd. During George Floyd. The young brother, I think he was killed like at a Wendy's or something like that. The police came, he was sitting in his car, and they killed him. She recused herself from that case. She tried to recuse herself. I mean, these are the cases for the people. Where the people at? The hell the people catching? She said she went to Howard, this black school. Like, she's black. She's pro-black. Her father was a Panther. Like, I don't even understand how that's even possible. But she said her father was a Panther, and this is what her father produced. That's the kind of person he produced. She went and got somebody that was not qualified to take the job. What's his name?
Rashard
Brooks. Google that up. Put Fannie Lewis and put Rashard Brooks in there. Put Fannie Lewis and put the and put teachers. Just put Fannie Lewis and teachers. Yo, all this stuff is gonna pop up. Cause I went and looked. I didn't go look in any revolutionary paper. I looked in NPR. I looked at MSNBC, New York Times, CNN, and what the young lady just said on this TikTok just now is basically everything that they were explaining. That she has been doing. Never stood on the side of the people. Never worked for the people. But as soon as she messes up, she runs straight to the people. She go in that black church, stands on that podium, blaspheming. Blaspheming and lying. Talking about as soon, like, I hired one white woman. I hired one black woman. My daughter said I use the same voice for everybody. I don't care. It still sounds funny to me. So I had one white woman. To do that as soon as I hired a black man. No, man. That's not why they're coming after you. And they're supposed to come after you. You've been working for them. You their slave. You their dog. They're supposed to come after you, man. But why are they coming after you? You see, when they come after us, when Ralph Baraka takes me to court, he brings the police, he stops me from entering venues, I don't have 50 lawyers for me to go get to take them to court. You see, so I can't use this system against them. You see, but Trump is a different breed. He's a sociopath just like the rest of them. And he got money more than most of them. So now he got her in court. He got like 50 lawyers in the court. And those 50 lawyers are on her. They're making her answer for everything she's done. See, I couldn't do that. If she locked me up, she locked one of us up, yo, we'd be in the county hoping to get a pool attorney that's going to come help us get out. But that it don't work like that with Trump. You see, but you get too cocky and you forget where you at. You forgot who you was. Like, you don't have skeletons in your closet. You have skeletons. And all it takes is for somebody to take a little peek at those contradictions, and they're going to see who you are. So you take we take away the whole. We take away the whole and break it into two and understand the contradictions in those two to understand who she is. Who is she? Where did she go to school? What did she do as a job? What was her life? What did she wake up every single day to go do for 16, 20, 25 years that she worked for the government to attack our communities? That's what she did. That's who she is. See, that's one side. Now, what's the other side? Why are they saying that she's up here at court? I mean, why are they bringing her here to court? You go understand that side. I mean, look at all of it. Is he qualified? Nope, he's not qualified. He should have went to all those different boards for them to see if he was qualified, which they would have turned him down because he never tried a case like that. I don't think he never had a RICO case. But she bypassed all of that. I mean, because you start thinking like you're smarter than everybody. Even Roland Martin ain't co-signing her BS. But this is what they do, man, when they get in position of power. When we talk about class war, she is a prime example of someone in that position. And when they come after them, they revert right back to come back and get the masses to come stand up for them. That's what they did. That's what they've been doing the whole time. They go out there, they say, we need affirmative action. Affirmative action ain't for people in the hood. Keeping it a buck. Affirmative action is not for people in the hood. You're getting to live in them white neighborhoods. It's not for people in the hood. It's for the middle class Negroes. It's for people like Fannie. And her father was a lawyer. For those middle class people. That's what those things are for. Those things are not for us. But these are what they fight for. Oh, what do they fight for? Take away guns in our communities. Trigger gun laws. These are all the type of things that they go out there and they say like, we're fighting for. Ain't nobody in the hood fighting for none of that. I mean, you don't see them cleaning up the water. They're not cleaning the water. They're not bringing jobs for people to be able to survive out here. They're not even holding landlords and the people in the communities that's oppressing the people. They're not holding them accountable. Yo, Ras Baraka is about almost 10 years that boy been in power. Not one landlord has gone to prison, but thousands of people have been kicked out of their homes illegally. How is that even possible? How is that even possible? But it's little niggas selling drugs. Like you go out there, grab a kid that's selling weed, that's selling drugs here, and you lock them up. That's stealing. Yeah, they stole. They stole something. So you lock them up, but you don't go investigate all the people that's making them who they are. You go inside the schools, the kids can't read. They say their proficiency, 17%, 10%, 15%, 5% proficiency. None of those people are held accountable. Roger Leone is not held accountable for his failure. But you go right inside the community. What does Fannie Lewis do? She go inside this community and target the people in the community. And then she runs and says she's fighting for the people. Now, I brought it back here. I wanted to go back to the kids that just got their report card. They got their report card last week. And when I went to pick them up, they were all happy. They were smiling because I told them I want them to be honorable. Like, we're not here playing. Like, they got a purpose in life. Their purpose in life demand that they know this schoolwork. They know everything that the teacher's trying to teach them, that they focus and understand the math because we have a bigger role for them to play in our community. And we express education. We push education. We push reading. Because if you can't read, you really can't find out the information. You can't know for yourself. You see, but if you want to change the communities, this is what you do. You go inside those communities and you work with the kids. Yo, like little bro right there looking up, right there, that's my little mans. That's Garcia. That's Archie right there. You see, I didn't know them before. I didn't know them before we started doing the after school program and I started going to go pick them up, talk to them every single day of their life. Understand what they're going through. What motivates them? You know what motivates them? They love Takis. These kids would do anything for Takis. They read a whole book in a day for Takis. So you want Takis? You eat all the Takis you want. I'm going to bring all of them. I give them Takis. Whatever they want, I bring it to them. Whatever motivation that they need, I bring it to serve them because we need them. We need these kids. We don't need them to grow up like Fannie Willis, using the state to oppress our own people. They need to know from early stage, understand dialectic materialism, understand combat liberalism, that lying, we don't lie, because we know people that don't skew our judgment or skew our analysis. We're real all the time. We're principled. Remember what we were talking about earlier about the brain? About the brain? Because like what you take in, everything that you take in from the outside world is what you use to be able to make decisions. We try to put stuff in that brain that's pro-black, that's pro-community, that's pro-people. That's the purpose. That's what you do. That's how you enter the community and change the community. You don't go get a job as a district attorney and then you lock up the teachers. And then you go after the drug dealers. You go after the gangbangers. While you're leaving in place the institutions that are bringing about all these social ills. Yo, it's really easy. Once you understand, you could tell these people. Fannie Lewis is a sociopath. She's a liar. Yo, there was another video. I'm about to play the video where they broke down her whole body language. And you can look and see that this woman is problematic. But how is she being allowed to rise up the rank, to go all the way where she's the district attorney? We're paying her over $100,000+ a year. What, you said 100+, right? She made like 160. She got her boyfriend. I mean, he get like 300+, and they go on vacations. So people could be catching hell. They don't care. Cop City, the people coming over there protesting, they disrespecting the people that's protesting against Cop City, the people that's protesting about the police killing black people in the streets. They calling those people crazy. Because they're not supposed to protest about their own slaughter. She's taking vacations everywhere. Napa Valley. Where's the other one they be going to? I think it's in Virginia. The Hamptons. No. I'm talking about the rich Negroes. They go to the Hamptons. Martha's Vineyard. Yeah, this are all the places that they go while we catching hell in our communities. And then as soon as the same people they serve, when they're ready to get them, they come and go inside their pulpit, get inside that church, and start talking about how they're pro-this, pro-black, pro, when they've been using their office to be the face of imperialism, to be the face of white supremacy. I have no sympathy for none of those people. Because if they really wanted to fix our communities, there's ways to do it. They go right
ahead. All right, so Fannie Willis took the stand yesterday. I don't know what kind of dress this is. I'll just address this now before the comments.
But let me pause it. You know, I was watching this with Captain Patience. I mean, we was watching this together. And while we was watching it, she was like, "Does she have a dress on backwards?" Yo, I couldn't really tell because, you know, like that's how they be making the dresses. But if you could look right there, you can see the zipper. It's on the wrong side. Don't nobody make no dress like that. The zipper's supposed to be on the other side. But she was like, "Why is her zipper like that?" But the reason why her zipper like that, because for the first time in her life, she has to answer to the people for her behavior. For the first time. And people always say like, "Yo, why are you challenging these politicians?" Because that's all they fear. They fear the people. Once the people get to see them for the savages that they are, they lose all credibility, even with their massa. So like she is under hella stress. She came, yo, bro. This woman came over here. This is a district attorney with her dress inside out. That's how you know how deep it is.
Start. Yes, that is a zipper that most women look at and go, "That is the back of a dress." But considering designer these days and the crap that we've seen coming out of them, it wouldn't surprise me if they turned it around backwards on purpose. And also her American flag pin is upside down. We're just a hot mess. Isn't that the appropriate way to say it? She's a hot mess.
All right, we're back.
So we have stress. They got the forehead wrinkled. We're playing with our mouth. Eyes non-blinking. Swirling in the chair. This is stress. People react differently to stress. Fannie is defiant.
Back on the record, Deputy Scott, if you could swear in our next witness.
Well, then I do apologize. Anna.
So we see her, she's quite defiant to the camera in the beginning, and now she's making a request. So she's going to make herself small, bring her arms in, put her hand up to her chest, and little one finger comes up. I'm not going to be dictatorial. I'm going to make myself small, but knowing that all these people know her and her request will be abided to. Like, I dare you to say no to me.
Give me a second.
So as you see that she's dictating for him to do, oh, wait a minute, you gotta swear at a public official, whatever. And so he stops. You can see that from the back monitor behind her.
Yo, these people master all the manipulative skills in the world. They know how to lie better than anybody else. And they think, like, because they've lied for so long, they've been frauds and scammers for so long, they think, like, it's going to work all the time with everybody. But they're about to learn.
Yes, sir. District.
So you see the stress continue in the forehead. We're playing with our fingers and the slight swivel in the chair.
District Attorney Fani, F-A-N-I. Last name is Willis. Ms. Willis, how did you know to come into the courtroom like that? There were people I was pacing in my office.
Okay.
And I heard someone yell, "This testimony is done." It only made sense to me that I would be the next witness. And I've been very anxious to have this conversation with you today. So I ran to the courtroom.
So as soon as
I've been very anxious, and you see that little period that she puts in with her head bob. Stress is still there. This is her biting. There's a few things we can take away from this. And one of the big things now is this really has stressed her. This tells me that in this arena, there apparently is consequences to her actions. And there has been a light shown. Because if there were no consequences, we wouldn't see the stress. Matter of fact, we wouldn't see her on this stage at all, more than likely. We do not know where the consequence is actually coming from. I'm doubtful that it's from her bosses. It could be the arena of public opinion, but who knows? Maybe it's respect where the consequence is. Maybe that's what she's losing. I have no idea, but whatever.
Highlighting their contradictions and holding their contradictions in the mirror up to them. Because they know what they're doing is wrong. That's where the pressure comes from. That's what they don't want. Usually when they're in rooms with other people that agree with what they're doing, that are part of the same game that they play. Like, everybody they have in the room work for them. So they be confident in being the sociopaths that they are, going after teachers, going after young kids in the community that are victims of the gang culture, but you're going after them. Those are the people that you're going after to go put in jail, to serve your oppressors, to serve the machine. And when you're in those rooms with the people that work for you, the people that are snakes just like you, you're comfortable. But for the first time, the camera is on and she know the whole world is watching her. It's watching her and is judging her and is understanding who she is. And that's what's stressing her. Any politician, and I'm telling you now, we're in a political education class. Every politician, wherever you're at, you want to hold them accountable? Approach them. Make the people see them for who they are, because that's what they don't want. That's why they have all these publicists. That's why they go on these platforms. They try to lie to people. Show the people who they are. That's the only way you can hold them accountable. Their bosses are not going to hold them accountable.
It is. It's giving her a great deal of stress. It's also making her defiant and trying to stand on whatever hill she's put herself on to try and keep the top of that hill.
You heard that Mr. Wade was done testifying. That's when you just assumed you would be the next witness?
It only makes sense.
Did you listen to any of the testimony?
I've been in my office pacing, ma'am.
Okay. Did you listen to any of the arguments?
I did hear the arguments this morning. It's ridiculous to me that you lied on Monday, and yet here we still are. And I did listen to that argument.
So even more and more stress. We go back. I did listen to that argument. She does like this little cooch thing with her butt to get more into that chair. She's finding her ground. Got the tight lipness in the face. Huge amount of stress in the forehead. She's ready for war.
All right, so that was it. Just the argument. No testimony.
Right, I listened to the argument this morning where Adam Abadi, I thought, did an excellent job pointing out how dishonest you were with the court on Monday. And I'm actually surprised that the hearing continued. But since it did, here I am.
You see another scoot in the chair. She keeps pushing, I'm assuming the defense. The defense is not taking her bait.
About what you did in preparation for today. Did you meet with Mr. Wade at all? Once the motion was filed, did you meet with Mr. Wade and talk to him about the motion that I filed to disqualify you?
On January, this first January motion?
Yes.
I don't know if you could say talked about. I probably had some choice words about some of the things that you said that were dishonest within this motion. So I don't know that it was a conversation.
All right. Basically, at this point, we're starting to realize how Fanny works. Very argumentative, very defiant, and very, I guess the best word is baity. She's baiting. She's trying to bait it. And I'm actually surprised just answering the question hasn't been told to her. Just answer the question.
You know why I didn't told her? Because she's part of the machine. You know, any one of us go in a courtroom and you talk, I've been in court, and you talk like that, yo, they already hitting you with what? Contempt of court. The judge already done jumped on you a couple of times. Just answer the question. Yo, she was up there on her father, and they just told stories forever. Yo, you don't know. That judge could be a Democratic judge because they have no principles. They have no principles. They don't go by decorum, by the law. They do whatever they want to do up there. You see, if any one of us is sitting up there, yo, this whole process is entirely different. But her, and this is part of the things that gave her the false confidence to think she could come up here, she could get, yo, she wasn't even supposed to be up here. Her lawyers were fighting against her coming up here for her to testify. She came on her own because she's smarter than everybody else. But let's finish this out.
Do not accuse the questioner of this, blah, 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 blah. I could see it if it was the other side. You know how that would go. But again, you see the leeway. It's almost like she wants to actually cross-examine this lawyer, and she's having to do it from the witness chair.
You know, Mr. Wade is a Southern gentleman. Me, not so much.
Okay, but
we definitely see that. Me, not so much. Held tip. She's biting. It actually wouldn't surprise me, as unprofessional as this type of personality is, she figures out some way to go after these lawyers and everyone in the courtroom that helped get her into that hot seat. So we're going to let this play a little bit. If I see something, I'll yell. And I'd like to see, as her testimony progresses, does she become more comfortable in her defiance, or does she start to realize that behaving that way is not a good light?
Question was, did you have a conversation
with him? I didn't have a substantive conversation.
You did not?
I read this motion, skimmed it more so, and I've probably said some choice things to him about some of the lies they were told.
Okay.
And then put it in the media because, you know, we used to be in a day and time where you had 60 minutes and people did stories and they verified information. And you had this great reporting, but it seems today that a lawyer writes a lie and then it's printed for all of the world to see.
Well, I just want to make sure that you answer the question I asked, though. So my question was...
We'll get that, Jack. That's been asking
it. Overruled, Mr. Bowden.
I told you what happened. I read the motion. I am sure I told him what my opinion of it is.
Okay.
And past that, we had no substantive conversation.
You did not.
Is it something you didn't understand?
No, I just wanted to make sure that okay. You did not have a meeting with him in the conference room to discuss the motion.
Next question, Ms. Marshall.
So in the conference room of my office, within this week, you produced some financial document. That financial document was given to me, something, and I'm not even sure who's given it to him by me or Mr. Abadi gave it to me. And I think he showed me a document in our conference room. But as far as a substantive conversation, I don't believe I've had any conversation with him that is substantive related to this.
Okay.
I have had conversations with him since you filed the motion, but they wouldn't be substantive to this. He sent me very nice sermons that have been done. And so we've had conversations about, did you listen to that sermon? You know, things of that nature. And I would say they were in relationship to this because I think he did it to be kind.
Let's start back in 2019.
Yep.
So you and Mr. Wade met in October 2019 at a conference?
That is correct. Okay. I think in one of your motions you tried to implicate I slept with him at that conference, which I find to be extremely offensive. I stayed at that conference. Mr. Wade was my teacher. I did not meet him when he taught the class. I was standing outside talking to Lisa Reeves, who is a judge. Me and her were just having a conversation. Mr. Wade walks up and they hug each other. They have some brief conversation.
This is what I'm talking about. I don't want to hear all of this, bro.
Take exception to
it. All right. Well, Ms. Wills, you'll have the opportunity to explain all of that when it's the state's turn to ask more open-ended questions. Yeah. Ms. Merchant.
Thank you, Judge. So again, my question was, you all met at that conference, right?
We did. The meeting. Okay. He taught the class. I did not actually meet him when he taught the class.
Jesus Christ.
I walked out of the class. She had worked at a law firm I worked at.
Question asked by Ms. Merchant. These answers are more than appropriate.
Ms. Merchant, if you want more concise answers, perhaps you could lead the witness.
I will. Thank you, Judge. Isn't it true that you met Mr. Wade October 2019?
I mean, we haven't gotten to the point where Ms. Willis should be treated hostile.
I think we have.
I very much want to be here, so I'm not a hostile witness. I very much want to be here.
Not so much that you're hostile, Ms. Willis, it'd be an adverse witness. Your interests are opposed, Ms. Merchant's.
Thank you. Your interests are contrary to democracy, Your Honor, not to mine.
So I kind of let that play it on, but I wanted to see how it was going, and she's becoming so, so defiant. She's arguing with the judges. She's arguing with all the lawyers in the courtroom.
His credit card to buy the cruise and buy the flight, correct?
I have no idea how he paid for it, okay. If it's a credit card, if it's a debit card. Certainly he called his cruise agent. You know, like how many people have a cruise agent? He calls his cruise agent, tells them where they want to go. They tell them what's booked. You have to remember, he paid for that initial was me, him, and his mother.
And then after that cruise, you all flew to Aruba and spent a couple of days in a hotel there, correct?
Right, and his mother was not happy.
He initially paid for that. He initially paid for that.
For Aruba, yes, ma'am. Okay.
So let's talk about both of those. I know he initially paid for it. Did you pay him back?
For the cruise and for Aruba, yeah, I gave him.
So she's got good eye contact, and right where she goes in, I gave part, she breaks off her eye contact, because that's the lie.
Money before we ever went on that trip.
You gave him cash?
And then we got to lick our lips go tight, our body's already still through this whole thing, because she's lying.
Before you ever went on the trip?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so when you got cash to pay him back on these trips, would you go to the ATM?
No, lady.
You would not go to the ATM?
No.
Okay. So
she's asking her where'd you get this cash from? If you gave it to him, and now she's leaning back, she's going away, she's bringing her hand up to her chin, she's trying to hide. Stress in the forehead. Oh no! Pretty much. I sit there and noticed, I was scrolling on the bottom, watching the body, I was like, oh, I'm waiting for this because this is a big movement change. Whenever her hand's coming up around her face and staying there around the neck, face, it's like there's deception, like a really big thing of deception. I am not going to go through this whole testimony. Why? Because this woman irks me.
Well, she irked me too. Nah, for real, like I'm done looking at it. But after I went into it, after I broke it apart and I looked at it, yo, man, she's a liar, man. She's like every one of these class traitors, man. She's a traitor. She's a traitor to our people, and she deserves whatever they do to her. Like, I don't know if y'all watched Django, but it was at the ending of Django, when what's his name? The old guy, whatever, Steve, whatever his name is, like he was trying whatever to come out of that fire, to come out. Nah, what you call it? Jamie Foxx was like, nah, stay in there. You belong with them. You stay over there. Yo, she belong with them, man. Whatever they do to her, whatever she get, she deserved all of it. She deserved no sympathy from nobody. She has made an entire career of attacking our communities. Nobody should be taking up for her. The only people that take up for her are the people inside that circle that do the same thing to our people every day. And I've been seeing them. I see them on social media, putting quotes up there. I won't demasculate, whatever, a black man. Yo, you've done it to a lot of them. Young Thugs, like, what is it, 2 years he's been going through that trial? You've done it to a lot of them. You don't care. It only benefits you. I mean, you did something grimy. You gave that money to him. You gave him that job that he wasn't qualified for because you're not principled. And if you're anybody out there, if you would give jobs to people they're not qualified for, you deserve whatever you get. See, we principled. I'm not going to go put nobody in a position that they're not qualified for. Why would I do that? Like, I'm real. Like, I can't even lie to people. Yo, I can't talk to people on the telephone if I'm not going to tell them the truth. Yo, I'd rather not even pick up. Keeping it a buck. I mean, but this person, she's not principled as hell at all. And whatever she get, whatever happens to her, she deserve. I mean, and if you see people, you want to be able to tell the difference between who's working for the people and who's not. You'll see the work that they're doing. See if they're invested in the community. I'm not talking about making speeches or just talking. See if they're invested in working with the communities. Or are they talking to those communities and using those communities to climb the social ladder or like in their jobs to get to move up the ladder in their jobs? That's how you judge these people. But she's a bootlicking sellout Uncle Tom, like all these other fake politicians and all these people that work in the government, that work in the judicial system. Like, she, nothing about her is pro-black. I mean, and like, I'm gonna tell you, I don't need to see how this is gonna end. They gonna get her. She going down. She done. Whatever political career she thought she had, she's done. You ain't coming back from this. And they ain't gonna let you come back. Trump ain't gonna let you come back. I mean, because he got as much money as you do. And I'm gonna let it be known right now. As a Black Panther, as Panthers, we don't support Donald Trump. We believe Donald Trump is a fascist. Donald Trump is a fascist, just like Biden. Donald Trump don't care about our communities. Biden don't care about our communities. Fannie don't care about our communities. None of these politicians care about us. And that's why Huey P. was saying that, I don't remember what slide it was, but he was saying we had to put institutions in our communities that will serve the people, because all of these institutions don't. I wish I remember the slide so I could go to it and put it up. But he said that we have to build these institutions in our communities. We can't trust Black capitalism, because this is Black capitalism right here. I mean, we have to build these institutions in our community to help our people, to bring our people together, to produce the minds that will be able to deal with all of this. And how do we do it? Through dialectic materialism, historical materialism, not metaphysical, not wishing, not praying. No, you got to do the work. So every day, what do? We get the kids after school and we teach them how to read. How do you get kids that they're saying are from the worst school district in the state? How do you get them to read? How do you get them to sit down and focus? How do you get them to want to come every day? Because if you watched our videos or their exercise, I don't know if the comrade Tashawn on here, but Tashawn he put them through hell. He got the little circuit that they go through. Then they do their little boxing, learn about their boxing. Yo, this is work that they're doing. But every day when I come to pick them up, they're running to come get inside that car. They're running. They're happy. You saw the video where I put out there. They all had their honor roll. They was bringing it out to come show me. I mean, because we push intelligence. I mean, but these people, you can't trust these people, man. You shouldn't support these people. Not at all. The politicians in your community, the council people, all of those people, they serve the oppressor. There's no reason for you to be supporting any of them, going, giving them money, going to go vote for them. None of that is going to help us. You just saw Huey P. Newton say it in there. We have to put the institutions in our communities that help our people. That means like building our own schools. Yeah, we're on the plantation. All these public schools, all these schools is theirs. We have to build our own schools, and we can do it if we choose to, if we decided to. We can't wait for people like Fannie, like Obama, like Roz Baraka, whatever Black politician that you have, wherever you're at, even white, they're not coming to do anything for you. Hispanic, whatever you want to call them, they're not doing nothing for you because they serve Wall Street. They serve the oligarchs. She serves them. I didn't need to really go look at her background to understand what team she plays on. Because as soon as I saw she was a district attorney, I already know what she about. That she's not here to help the people. She's here to oppress them, to put her boot on the neck of the people, and then go on trips every 3 months, flying all around the world, to go use that money to live her best life, where she think her best life is. And then buying men. Because that's the only way that dude will be with her. She bought him. I think he's 40, she like 50-something. She's not a kid no more. She grown now. That thing don't look like it used to look before, keeping it a buck. So she got a bob man like that, or he wouldn't be around her. You know, as soon as I put it on that song, I thought about Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. You go put Fresh Prince of Bel-Air on. You know, the lawyer that they got on there looked just like him. I won't be surprised if he was a prototype for that clown they got it on the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air show. But this is all class war. These people are in a whole different class, and they don't give a damn about the people. And that's what I'm trying to let you know. They don't care about us. We shouldn't be looking to them for help. We can only look at each other. That's why we had this political education class. And that's what dialectic materialism teaches you, to understand the world from a scientific perspective, not listening to them and believing what they're talking about. Remember what I said earlier? The world had two ways. It's two ways that people have been looking at reality, being able to like judge what's going on. It's been metaphysical. Where she was at? She went in that church. She went in that church because that's what they use. They use the church, the bully pulpit, to construct, to socialize our people, to construct the idea of what it is, put that stuff in their brain. So now they have that stuff in their brain. The only way people can really make decisions is by going deep, going in that brain to dig out the church, the metaphysical crap that they've taught them. And they use that to analyze the world in front of them. Instead of going into this woman's career and understanding she's been a traitor to our people her whole entire life. And then finding out the person she gave the job to, she was sleeping with him. You think they're not going to find out you were sleeping with him? You think like they're not, like, you know. Yo, the first thing she would tell you, if she was your lawyer, she would tell you to shut up and not speak. But you become so arrogant when you're in that position, when you've been getting away with it your whole life. She's 50. She's been getting away with this stuff her whole life, taking people to court. Yo, can you just imagine what she was saying about these families, this teacher that she took to court? Can you just imagine? To hell with them. But she got cancer. She about to die of cancer. I don't care. And like, don't hold me to this. But I guarantee you it has something to do with the charter schools. Because those were public schools that she came after. And this was during the time, 2008, 2009, when they were bringing charter schools in. I don't know. Those people was probably against the charter school movement. So she went after those teachers. She went after those people. This low-hanging fruit. That's what she is. What's another low-hanging fruit? Went after the gang members. Refused to hold people accountable that shoot black people in the streets. Refused to hold people accountable that kill people that's protesting Cop City. She's always on the side of the oppressor. So my verdict is, she's a boot-licking Uncle Tom, and she deserves whatever she get from those people, man. And I'm done with her, y'all. I'm done. They all power to the people. Anybody got anything they want to say? Anybody want to say something? I've been on here for more than an hour. I don't see no name. I'm about to start calling people. I'm about to start calling. Tracy, what's up, Tracy? You always got something for me, Tracy. Talk to me, Tracy.
I don't know. It's a good comment. I don't have no questions, you know, because we've been talking throughout the week. Oh. So basically, what I see is basically what the miseducation of the Negro basically got the job and used it against the people. And that's basically that what they do is not to help the people, is to just to benefit from her people. And when she get in trouble, she want to run to the people and ask them for help. And it's like, we posted said, well, all the things you've done before, now we supposed to feel sorry for you? No.
Yeah. And on some real, Tracy, like most people really don't know, because they're so busy trying to survive. They don't really understand what she's doing. They don't understand what she's been doing in her career. People don't know. People busy trying to pay their bills. Like, yo, it's hard to pay your bills out here. People need 2-3 jobs to be able to survive out here. And sometimes you get 2 jobs, you still got to participate in the underground economy to survive. I mean, so like people are not paying attention. I mean, but like I said, the first duty of a revolutionary is to be educated. I mean, so as soon as people started hitting me up, sending me links, I went to go read up about her. And then all this stuff started coming to my mind. I started remembering, because I remember when they took the teachers to court. I remember that. I'm like, yo, it was her? I mean, but yeah, and everything that we do, everything that we believe, I mean, we use dialectic materialism. We use science. We don't just believe what somebody says. Like, I can tell you something right now. Everything that I told you today, yo, you should go look it up. You shouldn't just believe it because I say it. I mean, go look it up for yourself. Understand it. Understand it, too. If you need to look me up, go look at my social media page. Look at what I write. Look at what I say. Look at what I do. And then see if I have the credibility for me to even be able to make judgment on what I see. That's how it works. You got to do some work. Or else people will just be telling you what to believe. I mean, but hey, thanks a lot, Tracy. Anybody else got anything? Saquon, you, hey, Harris, you got something?
Saquon.
I know. Hey, that's good. Hey, that's why I caught myself, my boy. Saquon, Saquon. Because I looked up there, I see the IN. Saquon, my bad, bro.
It's all good, King. I'm great. It was a good class.
All power. So you understand what dialectic materialism is?
Yeah, absolutely.
All power. Now, because that's going to be on the test. And if anybody have a problem with it, you'll hit me up. Your intercommunalism, that was the last part. That's what UP Newton was talking about. It's us working in our communities. Because, like, if City Hall are not going to work for us, we have to build communities inside the community. Like, I mean, so it's like, yeah. And that's what intercommunalism is, like working community to community. That's what UP Newton said. I mean, but yeah, but if nobody else got something, man, we about to wrap it up. Yo, and I'm thankful to everybody that come out. I cannot wait till we graduate so we can start working together, putting stuff in the community together. I mean, and I also want to thank Tashawn for coming out. I want to thank Captain Patience. She helps out with the homework program. I want to thank General Secretary Patience. Yo, she helped put this, put the program together, put everything together. I want to thank her too. I want to thank her for the housing. But she about to make an announcement real quick. Go ahead, make
that. I put the links for the preparation for next week's class. So please copy and paste. The links is in the group chat to prepare for next week's class. Thank you.
Yeah, so we could make it like, I really want to keep this to an hour. I don't want to keep people here too long. So like, try to look at those videos and stuff. And then we ain't got to go through the whole slide, reading the slide and stuff. Because ain't no shortcuts. I need everybody to know these things. Everybody to know what we're doing over here so we can understand how we're moving. I mean, ain't nobody trying to catch nobody slipping. I mean, but like, try to look at those videos. And once again, yo, I thank everybody for pulling up, y'all. All power to the people.
All power.
All power.